You're probably gonna have to edit this out because it's
Okay.
probably gonna sound a little weird, but like I don't like ever want to stop talking to you.
No, it's fine, and I feel the same way. If you had tits, I'd fuck the shit out of you. I'd be like, get the fuck up here. Like, I'm a sapiosexual, so I'm licking your brain right now. And there's no porno. No porno, no homo, whatever. I don't care about that shit. I don't believe in individualism, so
Or
I'm not
at
insecure
the
about any
very
of this.
least, I guess I can say at the very least, I never want to stop listening to you.
Yeah, well, I'm just happy to finally be fucking appreciated at that level. So, yeah, I'm not editing that out. I'll fucking make this the beginning of one of the sections so I can share this exactly, this moment, to show other people who are not as smart as you the respect that people like you and I deserve but don't fucking get. There's a prejudice against intelligence. It's worse than any racism that's ever existed, and it's been here since before racism existed. There's always been a
Facts.
minority of little gray aliens, and we've always been abused, made fun of. We're the weird one. And nowadays, they will label you crazy when you say something that they don't understand. And then if you don't know what you're doing, like, you might believe it after a while, like I did. I had so many people, my stepfather, you know, school, my peers, they didn't know shit about psychology at all. And technically, they're actually the crazy one. And they were telling me that there was something wrong with me, like I had, you know, depression or I had some sort of problem. But I realized much later in life I shouldn't have believed them, you know, because like at that point I was an individual. I didn't know what I know now. And so I'm like,
First
well,
blood.
maybe they're right. Maybe there's something wrong with me. Like after a while, you start to doubt your sanity because if some people tell you it enough and you don't know, then it becomes scary. And then you don't know what you are, and you want answers. You want to be able to fill in the blanks with something and say, I know what I am. I know what I am. I got this. I have depression, or whatever it is. And that's part of what makes me me. And then people start using it as a crutch, why they can't do something, why they aren't, you know, don't pick on me because I have depression. They use it all these different ways, and it becomes part of them. It becomes a self-affirmation, becomes part of what their concept of self that doesn't actually exist anywhere but in their own mind and in others' perception, the perception of consciousness. And then after I realized that pretty much everyone is just stupid and didn't know what they were talking about, and that I learned how to differentiate the difference between theory, fact, opinion, hypothesis,
Incoming
and what the value of it was, really be critical of it, then I realized
Find
that
evidence
I
spawned.
was likely insane at one point, but it wasn't because of a mental disorder or me necessarily as an individual. It was that the world is so crazy that it abused me so much to the point where it gave me disorders. Plus, them brainwashing me with weaponized psychological ad hominem in order to act like, you know, in order to make themselves feel safe. But I end up believing it, and then they manifest a mental disorder or illness into a life form, a form of consciousness, where it never should have existed. And that's something that, like, I saw a meme, I don't know, a few years ago. It said, before you accept a diagnosis of depression or something like that, make sure that you're not hanging out with a bunch of fucking dickheads first. And I add to that, make sure that you're not just smarter than everyone else. Because that's probably what it is that you're just way fucking smarter than the majority. And again, I'm bad at basketball, I'm bad at all sorts of shit. My dick is only 7 inches, you know? I'm not fucking John Holmes. I can't work outside, I'm bad at a lot of things. But I am way fucking smarter
Isn't
than
five
everyone else.
average?
I think 5 or 6, and so I have a slightly above average in length and a slightly above average in girth. But guess what?
Okay, we're both okay.
Guess what? It looks gigantic because I'm a tiny little hobbit. So my slightly above average dick looks gigantic on my tiny hobbit body. And I'll pull it out and a bitch will be like, oh my god, like I can't believe it. And then I'll get it inside her and she's like, oh wait, it wasn't that big. Like you can fold that thing over if you want. And I'm like, yeah, I guess I will. Or I'll strap a dildo to it and do you double up. And she's like, well, it's okay. Like, you know, you're already there and you're actually good at this. So, and holy shit, you can edge like a motherfucker. Look at the control. oh my god, we can get off at the exact same time. I've never been got off by a actual real penis before. And then she's addicted. Addicted. Wants sex all the time from my just average dick. And I mean, I'm good at it. I am. I'm not bragging. It's a curse.
That
it
aside,
sucks. Yeah, sure.
I did have one other thing to say on the previous topic.
Okay.
In attempting to describe yourself, you have taught me more about myself than I have learned in the last 10 years.
How old are you?
30.
Okay, so I got 7 years on you. And when I was your age, I didn't have all this figured out. I had a lot of it figured out, but I've been teaching people this shit for a long time. And so all you're really seeing is you're seeing your own phenotype expression with emergent phenomena factors 7 years from now, you know, I mean, hypothetically. And it's rare. It's really rare. And again, like, we're going to be good friends, I can tell. And normally I don't tell people about all my YouTube shit immediately, but I've talked to so many people, examined so many people, that I knew that it was okay to tell you guys immediately about everything. And the other guy that was with us, he was tired, so I can't make a really judgment call on his phenotype, but likely he's not where we are, but he's pretty bright, and he can understand what we're saying, but he doesn't relate to it like you do. He's not like us. But he's likely pretty smart, too.
I would agree with that assessment.
He's younger, too. He's younger than us. Gotta give him a little bit of time. But at any rate, I've studied these levels of complexity, this emergence, and intelligence specifically, and understanding how people devise their perception of reality, and then how that affects their psychological state, and therefore the mass sociological state, and our civilization, and our systems, and thought models, little equations of thought, like learning your multiplication tables, except it's like bifurcation logical fallacy has become a thought model that people use. 1 + 1 equals whatever the fuck we want, or it's either this or that, and that's all there is all the time, or filling in the blanks with an opinion. Well, I don't know, I'll just fill in the blanks with something. And then authoritarianism, just accepting authority or asking authority for the answer instead of learning how to think. All these are thought processes and modeling that is the product of religious ideology from Western and from a simpler, more simple time when we were more like a pack of wolves. And there's a hierarchy and there's the alpha male and the beta, and we're outgrowing that. And that's the other thing, that the reason why the majority don't like people like us, because they still have that remnants of animalistic nature of the alpha and the beta. And physically, they're the alpha, and they're used to like being able to muscle their way into whatever they want. And now with the age of the internet, now it's whoever thinks, has the best thinking, is the alpha in like a forum or whatever. And they don't like that. They're not used to that. Like, probably innate genetics even make it so that it's a situation that they aren't prepared for. And then if they, in the real world, they get to push their weight around a bit, like whether it be in a group of people, say it's me, you, and five other people that are simple-minded, and there's one of them that's really big. Well, that one will interrupt us. He will badger us. He will try to trivialize us. Anytime we say something intelligent, they'll say something facetious, troll us, and try to assert dominance over us and the others, because they're not afraid that we will kick their ass physically. That's how simple and brutish they are. And then they get on the internet, and that it makes them out of their element. They can't do anything about, they can't bully me on the internet. And so, I have to be careful. I'm trying to figure out how to slay trolls and crush that type of person, because they spread the status quo. They convince people who will become an apath to their sociopathic tendencies, or become the beta to this alpha mentality. Like, everybody following Trump because he's portraying the alpha confidence, and I'm the man, and I say what goes, and he's a big dude, so you could, like, maybe he could kick my ass even. And so there's all this instinctual, like, follow shit for the certain level of complexity that we display in our phenotypes. And 115 IQ or whatever, 110, 100, when they hear Trump speak, they hear their own thoughts. So they're voting for themselves, basically, which is really arrogant because it's like them saying that they are actually would be a good person to wield power and rule the world when they barely know how to change their own diaper or whatever. Like it's insanity that they can think that. And then, of course, a lot of them are young and don't have a fully formed logic center either, because that happens at average of 26 to 30 years old. And then they have to master that power and know how to think. So all of these things don't happen, then they are not a judge for anything. And this is the failure of democracy. And I'm not popular on social media very much. People like you like me. It's like very few people like me, but the people who like me, they like me a lot. And then there's these people...
Sorry, this is off topic.
Sure.
I just made an observation.
Sure.
I've been listening to you speak this whole time and not really focusing on anything else, and I have done better at this game than I have ever done.
Mm-hmm.
I have just been running fucking riot, which I find really amusing.
Same thing for me a lot of the time. It's like, try without trying, and when you're really focused on it, sometimes you'll over-aim or you'll get a little bit clusterfucked, and then if you take just enough of your focus away from it and you just play it in the background... You go on autopilot, and you don't even pay attention to it, and your brain just does it. I do it when I drive my car, too. I'll stop for stoplights. I'll stop from running something over. I will react to the situation perfectly and avoid damage, and I'm not thinking about it, focusing on it at all. Before I know it, I've driven to my house.
I've actually heard scholarly discussion on why that is. I don't recall word for word, but it's basically because... The part of your brain responsible for motor skills is opposite from the part that is responsible for interpreting speech or music, and so it just frees up your mind by using your mind, basically.
I got you. Yeah, I had theories about it, but it wasn't that, and that makes more sense. Kind of like we've
got... 2.1 KDR for the last 10 games. That's insane for me.
Hell yeah. And also, you know what else it is, too, is that I started stimulating your mind, and because of the thoughts that and this excitement and the dopamine release of, you know, finding somebody who's like you, that's fucking rare. And so you basically get high off of that, and then that causes all sorts of neurons firing and activity in the brain. And like anything that I go to do, if I have a conversation like this with someone or whatever, and I stimulate my brain first, then I can kick in the flow state and do whatever I was going to do. It feels like locking it in, like calibrating the mind or whatever, gearing it up. And then I relate it to biohacking too, like caffeine and sativa and Adderall and that sort of thing. You can make that happen without the stimuli. But if I had, whatever, somebody like you all the time, I could probably wake up in the morning, just have water and an apple, and shoot the shit, and then before long, we'd be kicking in this flow state. We'd both be getting dopamine and serotonin, and we'd both be high energy. And again, like, I'm really happy that I met you just as much as you are happy to meet me. It's very mutual, and I invite you to join the thought revolution. I do think tanks. I have a Google community that is for discussions of outside-the-box scientific theory and geopolitics and solving our most pressing issues, and there is no arguing allowed, but you are allowed to issue a debate, challenge somebody, and then they have the option whether they want to accept that challenge or not. And I made another community called Settle All Debates Here, and I outline rules for the debate, and using the Google setup, you can do polls, right, like voting. And so the two people who are, you know, in the debate, one of them sets it up and sets the poll so you could vote for who wins and what their argument is and what side they're going to try to prove. And then they can go back and forth, and they're the only people allowed to speak in that forum right there. And everyone else who's reading it and seeing the debate happen, they vote up or down people's comments, and they vote on who they think won the debate ultimately. And then
truly fascinating.
Yeah, and so there's no more arguments. Like, opinion plus opinion equals opinion, and until you have consensus with a lot of different eyes on it, so that you have an impartial judges to a certain extent, and like, and then if they vote a certain way and they're wrong, I'm there to play the referee of logic and be like, well, I hate to break it to you guys, but you know, just because everybody voted against this guy over here, in this case, it's not actually the truth, and I'm going to tell you why. And then you guys can take what I teach you, and you can argue again. You can make a whole nother debate off of what I teach you, and you can, if you need to hash it out, you can debate it. I'm not going to debate it with you. I'm just going to tell you what I know, and you can do what you want with it. And at the same rate, you know, I won't delete it or whatever. I'll let them pretend, like, if they want to pretend they got the right answer, I'll let them, but I won't just be complacent with it completely. And I've got like 3 people or something that have joined that one. And like 86 people or something that joined the one with no argument. And so the people who are joining that, they're either people that don't like to argue, they don't like confrontation, they don't want that game. They want to just chill and have a conversation and add to each other's thoughts, right? Cooperatively solve the puzzle. And then, or it's people who they like to debate and they're curious as to what this is going to be like. And they probably also want to, at some point, try to debate with me and like see what happens, which it, ultimately they'll turn into a troll because I don't like debate at all. To me, it's insulting most of the time. Like making a game of science and my life's work, and when people fill in the blanks with opinions instead of admitting they don't know something, it's kind of like saying that everything that I did over the past 17 years to try to create rigid critical thinking models to come up with accurate assessments and understand the complexities of reality and learn all this science and shit, we're talking fucking years and years and years of just no pussy, no partying, no friends, no life, no family, no job, no human interaction to speak of. Monk on a mountain, except I had dial-up internet so I could access Wikipedia, and I had Netflix, 5 movie plan, shit tons of documentaries, and then I started pirating, I started interacting with people a little more, started studying people through Xbox Live. I could bridge my dial-up connection and play Magic the Gathering arcade game and have a one-on-one private conversation on 360 perfectly well. So I did that every single day and had like this conversation I'm having with you as much as I could. And I studied people.
I paid you for a Magic player. That's funny.
Yeah, it's the greatest card game that I've ever seen. And anybody who's good at that is going to be good at being a lawyer, because lawyers all about remembering these little particular wordings and rules and then twisting it and using it to make sure that they are right about however it is. That attention to detail and shit. But I hate lawyers. My parents wanted me to be a lawyer because even at like 14, 12, 11, 5, they couldn't beat me at an argument. They knew I was right about everything, even though they couldn't let me have my way because of society's bullshit and they're fake. But they wanted me to become a lawyer because they knew that I would be this unstoppable lawyer. And I don't like argument. I don't like fighting. I don't like debate. I didn't like sports. My stepfather made me play sports, and I hated it. He tried to make me into this thing that I don't want to be. He wanted me to be it so that he could be like, I've got the honor student who's an athlete and goes to college, and I did a good job raising this problem child that the mother couldn't control and didn't know what to do with. I succeeded. I validate my existence and my overpriced education. I'm a smart guy. I know what to tell people to do with their kids now because I've had this hellion child that refused to be dominated. But no, he failed miserably. He failed so miserably. Every time he tried to control me, it just made it worse. Until by the time I was 12, I just wanted to rip his head off, chase him out of his own house. He'd like chase him up the flight stairs. He's locked in his bedroom. I'm trying to kick his door in. He's crying. That might have been when I was like 16 or something. But 12 years old, he wouldn't wrestle with me anymore because he'd piss me off and like tell me to stand up and sit down 100 times or go up and down the stairs flushing the toilet because I forgot to flush the toilet, and like I'd be so mad. I'd be good though, and then I'd be at the end of the night, I'd be like, I've been good, let's wrestle, it's my reward, let's wrestle. And then as soon as he said yes, I'd start going for blood and try to really hurt him and put him in a headlock, start trying to rip his head off, and he's like, okay, we're not gonna do this anymore, no more wrestling. And that was the end of like our relationship too, really. About when I was 12, I was just like, no more, you're not controlling me, He still got to because he's bigger than me. He could have kicked my ass for my whole life, but, you know, he's psychologist and rational and a decent human being, so he didn't. But at the same rate, he was a control freak, and he wasn't as smart as he thought he was, and he had more too much faith in his religion of psychology. Whereas, whatever the fuck this thing is that we call arbitrarily Adam, it's an emergent phenomena, and it is not understood by putting me in a box or saying because of this or that, that means this. I wouldn't listen to him. I wouldn't listen to my mom. By the time I was 14, I was telling them that my mom was a school teacher. I told her she was running a brainwashing camp. She was just conditioning and breaking kids. I don't remember my exact words, but that was basically it. She, no joke, this is physically, no exaggeration, she plugged her ears, like 35-year-old woman or something, plugged her ears, and walked out of the room going, la, 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 I can't hear you. And I followed her, and I kept on telling her the truth, and I wouldn't stop, and I got in her face. And she thought I was going to get violent, so she grabbed me by the hair and slammed my head into the floor. She got violent with me because I wouldn't stop telling her the truth. That was the first time I realized that thoughts can cause real harm if you don't let people look away from you. And it's what I call mind punching. Like, if someone fucks with me on the internet, mind punched into oblivion. Yeah, go ahead.
That reminds me to a great degree of Plato's Allegory of the Cave.
Oh yeah, I'm familiar with that. Familiar with that. I'll add to that, right? Like, I walked out of the cave, but I'm not looking back into the cave. Maybe I was when I was 14, but now I've walked out of the cave and I decided I would never go back to the cave. And I've made a fucking spaceship in comparison. Really, that's how far we've come out of the cave.
It just definitely reminded me of that. Because, yeah. Like, if you were to stand in front of the shadow puppets, that physical altercation that happened is exactly, I think, what he was getting at.
Right. Right. Okay. No, I never thought about that. So you're saying that part of what he was saying was that the shadow, maybe I've forgotten some of this, but the shadows that they're looking at on the wall is the reality that they see, and that's it. I got that part.
Exactly.
And then if you try to, like, shine a light on it and take away that shadow, then you're taking away the reality and causing them to, like, have some sort of existential crisis. It's taking away their psychological security blanket, and that's what causes them to attack you, right?
Exactly.
Yeah, okay. Precisely. So, yeah, that is exactly what happens. And this is what the prejudice against intellectuals at this point. And this is what's made me realize that I'm not compatible with the rest of the world, and the only way I'm going to be is if I assert myself as an authority. Whether the world likes it or not, I have to be beyond confident. Because if you come out and say that people's reality is fucked up, and that you know the right answers, and that you know how to think, and they don't, and that they're actually crazy, which they are, and you can prove it, and that you know how to fix all the world's problems to boot, you can't be like, in my humble opinion, well, I'm just a nobody, and in my humble opinion, this is what I would do. People be like, that's a cool idea, and you're cool, I like you, you're humble, you don't make me feel stupid, and like, I like this, that's a cool idea, but it's just your opinion, and it won't work because of pessimism and hopelessness and NWO and fucking all this other shit. Opinion. Never mind that if they actually let me try it, then we've got a scientific experiment. Then if I fail, they can say it won't work. But until then, they don't fucking know. But I can't say that because then they feel insecure and I'm a condescending prick. All of this. My only option is to assert myself as king shit of intellectual island. And I know that I'm smarter than 99% of the population. But even the study of intelligence is behind in this. I was going to tell you about this earlier. So old world IQ tests that are culturally biased, they're in English. They'll have questions that have to do with things you've learned in school. And like, here's a bunch of jumbled up letters. Answer is this a state capital, a car, or a type of a game, or a board game or something like that. Now, you'd have to know a bunch of cars, state capitals, and different board games to better your chances of easily answering that.
And that reminds me of the immigration tests.
Sure. So they created a test that isn't culturally biased. I want to point out that the test that we're talking about, the old one, that was actually designed for the purpose of testing people's usefulness to the industrial world. So they wanted to know people who could do good math for engineering, to build weapons and bombs and shit, and rockets, and people who were great memory as well, so they were very programmable. That way, you could remember all these equations and, you know, all the shit you needed to be a specialist, to be a neurologist. Well, I listened to Stephen Hawking's talk about anything but math, and he sounds like a simpleton to me. And my ideas are way more complex, well thought out, lateral, they're all over the place. And he would probably like talking to you and I as well. He would recognize that we have something. Actually, I've experienced this. Doug Koltler, backyard scientist, computer engineer, he's working on fusion technology at his fucking house. He used to work for the NSA. He's a brilliant guy, but he's a specialist. He's a coder and whatnot, and an engineer. And I'm abstract. I'm psychology. I'm sociology. I'm everything that he's not. And he said to me, he's like, whatever it is that you do, whatever it is that you have, I don't know what it is, but it's something. You have something. And it's much more impressive than everything that I do. But at the same rate, I look at what he does, and I'm in awe. And I want to know how to do all that shit too. But neither of us has the space to specialize that much at our different skills or whatever we got. And his mind is just as active and hyper as mine, and our minds don't exist in the same physical location, in the same proximity even. We have to talk through each other the entire time and type, because we both have too much to say. We can process what each other's saying at the same time and respond and have more room to where we have to use the text-based communication. And eventually, we don't really get along even though we like each other. Because he can't be quiet long enough to listen to my entire idea, and he'll think that he's inferred it, because normally he can infer what I'm going to say or what someone's going to say, but he can't infer what I'm going to say because it's beyond where he is. But he still tries, and then I get frustrated because he won't just shut the fuck up. But, like, both of us can't allow each other, right? Sorry, yeah, go ahead.
No, I didn't have anything profound to say. I was just going to say that that sounds like some sort of complication with evolution, honestly.
Yeah, it's an emergent phenomenon. Our complexities of our consciousness and our understanding and how quickly our brains work, it is something that has never existed at this level before, and it's largely because of the ability to absorb information so easily with the help of the internet. Once we had the internet, that was like another giant leap, kind of like making the printing press. And me having all the time in the world to just sit around and nerd out to computers and YouTube and Wikipedia and watch all these documentaries, download college lectures. I mean, dude, I took like two, three years worth of college psychology lectures, and I watched them all in like 2 months. So like, why would I wait for years and wait till tomorrow for the next lecture? I can watch it, I can pause it, I can go look up a word, I can rewind it, I can, you know, think about it. It's much more efficient learning. And
college
then to boot,
is useless.
It is. It is a fucking scam. And that's one problem I'm having here, and you mention it. The economic board doesn't care about making a bunch of jobs to make sure everybody's got what they need. They just want me to be an entrepreneur and make a bunch of tech jobs to justify all of the college students who can't find work so that they can continue to do their bread and butter, which is the college town thing, and sell education and a promise of a better life, which we all know is bullshit at this point. And I mean, they spend 25% of their profits on advertisement. And then what? They're going to pay a fucking college football coach like $1 million a year, and I'm supposed to pay for that when all I need is access to the fucking lecture? I don't even need to ask the teacher shit. And I don't even care about the degree. Just give me the fucking knowledge. I'll pay the teacher. So I made friends with that lecturer of biology I was mentioning. She works at the University of Michigan. And she teaches a wild plant identification and wild edible and medicinal plant identification preparation. And I know how to identify all the choice edible mushrooms already. I don't even need a book. I know them. I will survive. If we run out of food and, you know, people are dying and fighting over a can of corn, I'll go live in the woods and I'll eat mushrooms, which are a superfood, and everyone else won't know which mushrooms to eat, and they'll fucking hurt themselves if they try. Puke and fucking whatever, and they'll puke their guts out until they're so dehydrated and weak that they die. I'll have all the whores. Every fucking woman will be mine in the apocalypse. I'm gonna start legal prostitution, a brothel, have a trade program, trading different resources for fucking vagina. I'm just kidding, but I'm not. Partly kidding. But at any rate, I wanted to learn more about plants, and I've been finding that plants is way more difficult and complicated and wonderful and amazing. So many things I've learned about our biology and our symbiosis with all of the plant life around us and our biochemical states. And then
something
hanging out with her.
Something you said earlier just dawned on
me.
Yeah,
sure.
College campuses are the neo fucking libraries of Alexandria, because all a college campus is upper class corporate rich fucking America's attempt to restrict knowledge by an economic transaction that most people can't fucking afford.
That's right. That's right. It's like I was saying with the digital libraries of Alexandria and the fires of copyright infringement law. It is right in line with what you're saying with the colleges. They covet the knowledge of the ages that all life had a hand in gathering and producing, and they scrape the cream off the top, claim ownership over it, and then economically enslave us, our parents, our whole family, us for our whole fucking half our lives or something, all to gain access to this knowledge. Then on top of it, they lather in all this conditioning. They force a whole bunch of education that none of us need just to justify the sale of it and to justify their inflated value. Meanwhile, people every day, like 20% of the people who actually go into college actually finish. That's an old statistic. It might even be less than that now. And the tenacity, that really, it takes more complacency to make it through school than it does intelligence. You just have to be complacent enough to fucking get in line and show up every day and, you know, jump through the hoops and be what they want you to be. Tell them what they want to hear. It's fucking manipulative crap. I am not impressed. And I've never agreed with school. Not like kindergarten. Problem was, I was born in a farmhouse, no electricity, no running water in the mountains of Kentucky. My dad cut my umbilical cord. There's some hippies in the room watching my mom give birth. And I didn't hang out with any children, hardly at all, for the first 5 years of my life. I was with adults. My dad was brilliant. And so I was with a brilliant adult that was like, well, I'm not going to tell you what to do because I want you to learn how to think. So I'm going to give you a choice. I'm going to tell you what I know, but I'm not going to tell you what to do. You can do what you want. It's totally cool. You know, I don't own you. You're your own man. Go ahead, touch the stove if you want to. It's going to hurt. You know, I'm telling you, you're not going to like it. But, you know, if you want to touch the stove and, you know, test me, see if I'll stop you or whatever, go ahead. I'm not going to stop you. I'll let you learn from your mistakes. So I was treated like an adult from the start. And then when I get to, like, kindergarten and preschool and shit, they're ate up with retarded. They've been watching fucking Sesame Street and the Smurfs and MTV and drama and their parents arguing while getting drunk, and they're idiots, and I hated every single kid that I ran into. I hated school the whole entire time. I wanted out of it immediately.